Day dawns on a London saddened by Britain's great loss. This is the day of homage, of remembrance, of farewell. In the Great Hall at Westminster, the warrior rests, guarded in death by the military men he led during his nation's darkest hours. Thus begins 3 days of mourning for the man who served six monarchs, who wielded a mighty sword in his country's defense, and in the words of President Kennedy, mobilized the English language and sent it into battle. The cross, the trappings of his knighthood, the Union Jack, the candles. Nothing more is needed to do honor, nothing more to recall greatness. The stillness is broken only by the changing of the guard. Every 20 minutes, four others move to their places to dip swords, to bow heads. Westminster Hall adjoins the House of Commons that was the center of his life for six long decades. He saw the Victorian era evolve into the Atomic Age. As Big Ben and the bells of St. Paul's toll in mournful measure, the doors are opened for all to enter. They form a line that is miles long. They wait 2 hours to file by. The weather is London, the spirit British. For 3 days, this will be the scene. For 23 hours a day, the Great Hall will remain open. It was as he wished. In life, he wanted to be among people. He is not to be denied in death. The very young, to whom he is a legend, those who remember the horrors of the 40s, to whom he is living history, the old, to whom he was a link to a past long departed, they all come. They weep, they pray. They give thanks that they had the privilege of knowing such greatness. Within the first 24 hours, it is estimated that nearly 100,000 mourners had passed through the 11th century hall. An eloquent symphony of silence, broken only by muffled footsteps and murmured prayers. For 70 hours, the people will come. Then a state funeral, the first held for a commoner since Gladstone. Burial will be at the side of his father and his American mother. He himself vetoed burial.